to see so many people come out to pay homage to our dear brother, Fidel Castro Ruz. New York is a special place. And it was a special place for our brother Fidel. And so we're honored to be here. My name is Gail Walker, and I am with IFCO Pastor Patrice. I want to thank Dr. Drum and Bambayo, who I know will be and his compañeros for bringing us into this space in such a powerful and significant way. There's nothing like the drum. There's nothing like the drum, am I right? There's nothing like the sound of the drum to bring us together. So thank you, thank you, thank you for beginning, getting us started. So we're gonna have to shift a little bit. You can imagine with trying to pull together a program of this magnitude, we've got some people that are here, some people that have been tied up in transit, but we're all here to celebrate the life and the legacy of our dear brother Fidel Castro. And so we're looking forward to an exciting evening of celebration. I want to express our gratitude. I'm here with my dear brother Malcolm Sachs of the Vincent Ramos Brigade as co-moderator. And we're going to help to try to facilitate tonight's activities. We're honored that our friends here at the Malcolm X Betty Shabbazz Center have opened their doors for this historic event. This is history, people. It is most fitting that we're here in this historic place, which in so many ways represents hallowed ground. For those of us who have followed in the footsteps of giants like Malcolm X and so many others who have taught us what it truly means to stand for justice and to confront the empire. Undoubtedly, Fidel served as the bedrock of the world's greatest and longest socialist revolution. In addition to standing firm for his people in the face of the US empire's aggression, Fidel's unwavering expression of solidarity has benefited countless people across the globe, from Central America and Latin America, from Asia to Africa and beyond. Indeed, under the bold leadership of Fidel, we saw no limit to Cuba's support of the least powerful in our world, ranging from support of numerous African nations in their fight for sovereignty and against the racist apartheid regime, to the people of the Ukraine following the nuclear tragedy in Chernobyl, to support of those who fought to recover from natural disasters such as hurricanes in Nicaragua and Honduras and Guatemala, to the 2004 tsunami that struck Banda Aceh in Sri Lanka, and the 2010 earthquake that devastated Haiti, and of course, most recently, who can forget Cuba's brave fight against Ebola in Western Africa. While we have lost him, while we have lost our brother Fidel in flesh, we should never forget that Fidel's spirit and example continues to live on. When we remember his tenacious fighting spirit, when we proudly recall that he led a revolution that succeeded against the odds in toppling the pro-Washington dictator Fulgencio Batista, right? When we celebrate the graduation and the accomplishment of each graduate of the Latin American School of Medicine, right? When we witness the bold courage of a Cuban child, anybody who's ever traveled to Cuba knows exactly what I'm talking about, that bold and beautiful pride with which a Cuban child possesses and shows itself. It's all of these things that help us to realize that Fidel's spirit lives on. Long live Fidel Castro Ruz. So indeed, it's our privilege to welcome you here tonight. I'm going to pass the mic to my brother, Fidel. Malcolm.
Just the beard.
Just the beard.
Good evening. Again, I'm Malcolm Sachs of the Venceremos Brigade. Thank you, Gail, for the introduction. Thank you for your words. Thank you to everybody who's here tonight, to the performers, to the speakers, to the folks who make up the New York and New Jersey Cuba C Coalition who have helped to make this event happen. I'm really honored, really humbled to be here with you all tonight celebrating the life of Fidel. I hope I can speak for everybody here when I say that Fidel was and is and will always be a very special person to all of us. A real, true example of revolutionary leadership, of love for oppressed people around the world. The historic guide of the Cuban Revolution, and in many ways, he'll continue to be a source of inspiration and guidance for the Cuban Socialist Project, which, contrary to the hopes and attempts and desires of the ruling classes here and everywhere else, continues strong to this day. So as Gail said, we've got an excellent program planned for tonight, an evening full of love for El Comandante. And before we get started, we want to extend our solidarity and greetings. We want to recognize some of the folks that are here, in some cases representing people from all over the world. We know that here in the US, in the belly of the beast, the media likes to say that Cuba is isolated from the international community, that this recent opening by the US government is like the first time that Cuba is being exposed to the world. And we know that's not true. And we've got evidence of that here tonight in terms of the people who have come out to support.
That's right. Woo! Okay. So before we get started, we want to acknowledge some of our special guests that have joined us this evening. We have the ambassador from Vietnam, Ambassador Nha. Please. Thank you, Ambassador, for being here and your comrade with you. We really do appreciate that. We also have Arnaldo Barón. For those of you who don't know, he's best known as the leader of the July 26 coalition in the United States. Señor Barón was awarded Cuba's Medal of Friendship by Ricardo Alarcón, the former president of the Cuban Parliament, on behalf of the Cuban Council of State, for his long-standing struggle in the defense of the revolution before and after 1959. So we're grateful to have you here with us, Señor.
Not everyone on this list is here, but they've expressed their solidarity, so we're going to continue through this list. We have Ruby Sprott, a lay leader at the Riverside Church and a true fighter for social justice.
Is Ruby up? There she is.
There she is. Woo! Ruby has traveled to Cuba numerous times with Riverside Church and with IFCO's U.S.-Cuba Friendship and Caravans. She heads Riverside South African and Cuba Ministries. Thank you for being here.
Thanks, Ruby.
Also, formerly of Riverside Church, we have Dr. James Forbes, the former senior minister there.
Woo! Everyone.
Importantly, and we'll see a little bit of this tonight, he was the host of Fidel's historic visit to Riverside Church the last time he was in the U.S. in the year 2000.
Oh, great. Thank you so much, Dr. Forbes and Ruby. It's wonderful to have Riverside in the house. We also want to welcome Imam Mikael Abdus Samad, who is a longtime member of the Mosque of the Islamic Brotherhood, is the Imam Mikael with us?
Where is he?
There we go. Thank you.
He comes representing the mosque as well as Imam Al-Hajj Talib Abdur Shahid. So I apologize, but thank you so much for being with us, sir. And my dear brother, Daoud Andre, donde estas?
That's right.
Many of you know Daoud. Daoud is from the Eritrea Bakapa Dasalin, which organizes weekly Haitian community forums and a radio show, which connects the struggles of Haitian people throughout the world, including Haiti, Cuba, the Dominican Republic, and the United States, among other things. But we're grateful to have Brother Daoud here in the house. Thank you, Daoud.
Esperanza Martel, where are you? Cuba, a fighter for Puerto Rican independence, for the freedom of Oscar Lopez Rivera, who will be free very soon. A true friend of Cuba and a member of several of the French shipment caravans with IFCO and brigades with SNX. We also want to recognize Bob Guile, Vice President of Marasul Charters, another leading voice for many years in the Cuba Solidarity Movement and the movement for free travel to Cuba.
And is Pam Africa with us? Is Pam Africa here? Where's Pam? Is she here? Not yet? Okay, our hope is that she'll be able to join us. Many of you know Pam as the uncompromising leader of the International Concerned Family and Friends of Mumia Abdul-Jamal and the Minister of Confrontation. She's the Minister of Confrontation. I like that. Of the MOVE organization and an avid supporter of Cuba. You know, the problem with beginning to announce people is that you always forget people. There are many different people in this room who have been strong and avid fighters in Cuba's fight. And How's that? Better? All right. I was just saying the problem with starting to name people is that you always leave somebody off. But we welcome all of you here. Young and not so young and of all stripes and colors, we appreciate your being here, recognizing Cuba, supporting Cuba now and forever. So welcome, and thank you for coming out this evening.
One more thing to mention before we get into it. We want to just give a special thanks to WBAI for the continuing support throughout the years. Woo! And to thank our brother Mickey Melendez, who couldn't be here tonight due to some health issues, but has contributed importantly to this program, as well as Dr. Rosemary Mealy, educator, author, activist, long-time leading light in the Cuba Solidarity Movement. She has also contributed to this program in important ways, even though she's not able to be here.
All right, so thank you, Malcolm. And thank you, all of you, for being here. We would like to now ask our dear brother, Zaid Muhammad, to come forward. Zaid. Against all odds, coming from New Jersey, that Penn Station, that train. Well, we love Zaid, and we're so grateful that he's here. And we can't begin without some libations. And we need you to bring us in this space.
Everybody all right?
Yeah.
Que viva Fidel, que viva!
When I say Ibaye, y'all know what to say, right? Oh my goodness, wait a minute, wait a minute. This is Malcolm's house and the house that Betty built. When I say Ibaye, what y'all say? All right, let's go to work. For the four directions, for the north, the south, the east, and the west, we say Ibaye. 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 For the ancestor in whose name this building stands, who stood tall and dared to stand with this great struggle in solidarity when few would. For Malcolm, the one who taught us how to walk and stand tall, we say Ibaye. Ibaye. For his queen who resurrected this space so we can rally, continue to rally, carry on a tradition. For Betty Shabbazz, we say Ashe.
Ashe.
Some of the great revolutionaries of this neighborhood did great work. The great Carlos Cooks on the shoulders of Marcus Garvey. And Garvey, we say Ibaye.
Ashe.
Ibaye.
Ashe.
Don Pedro Albizu Campos, right here, worked in this hood hard. We say Ibaye.
Ashe.
Ibaye.
Ashe.
Ibaye.
Ashe.
And some of the ancestors of the long struggle for independence and revolution in Cuba itself. For Mati, the father of Cuban nationalism and independence, we say Ibaye. Maceo, the bronze titan, we say Ibaye. Mariana, the grandmother of it all, we say Ibaye. Che, for Che, he's going to be reunited with Che, we say Ibaye. And so for the north, the south, the east, and the west, we say Ibaye. 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 I say, oh, it is done. Let's go to work.
Thank you, Zaid, for opening us up in that way. So, first thing on the program, we regret that the representatives of South Africa, Namibia, and Angola are not able to join us this evening. But we have, thankfully, some video of them to share. Thanks to the work of our talented video editors, Jennifer Wager and Sally O'Brien. We have a video collection of statements from the representatives of these countries that were delivered during a United Nations tribute in December. So, enjoy.
On behalf of the people and government of Angola, in this ceremony in memory of the late President Fidel Castro. It was Fidel who decisively contributed to the consolidation of the independence of Angola when the country was faced with an invasion by the highly armed military apartheid South African racist regime. Some thousands of Angolans were trained at the Cuban schools, universities, and maybe more important, when the Cienfuegos contingent were dispatched to Angola to fill a dramatic shortage of teachers for secondary education in the years immediately following the proclamation of independence. Many Angolans would have lost their lives for lack of medical assistance if not for the timely dispatch of specialists willing to work in the most remote corners of the extensive territory of Angola.
What is the price of freedom? What is the cost of liberating a nation? How much do you pay a country which fought for you when others were allies of your enemy?
But the solidarity forged in the trenches of the battlefields of southern Angola by Cuban internationalists is a solidarity for which Namibia shall always be indebted. On 4 May 1978, an attack took place on a refugee camp at Kasinga in Angola, 2 days after the United Nations Security Council had discussed the situation there. This aggression resulted not only in the deaths of over 1,000 Namibians that day, and also of Cuban soldiers who were en route to assist the camp. This incident resulted in an immediate response by only one country, the Republic of Cuba, and by only one world leader in the person of Fidel Castro. He ordered that the children who had survived would be brought to Cuba where schools would be set up for them. Other Namibian children later joined them. So it was that two schools were set up on the island of youth in Cuba for Namibian children to study. This story is told and retold in our country. Many of these children have gone on to be leaders in Namibia, from doctors and geologists to economists and teachers. We further remember the Battle of Cuito Canavale, in which Cuban soldiers also gave their lives and which led to the implementation of UN Security Council Resolution 435 and the successful elections and independence of which Namibia is so proud. That the blood of the Cuban fighters indeed waters our freedom, something which we can never forget. To us, a cedar, the mightiest of trees, has fallen. We take solace in the fact that his outstanding legacy as a selfless leader and defender of liberty and fighter for justice and independence will continue to inspire the human race for generations to come. Fidel is indeed a hero.
We are honored to represent the government and the people of South Africa as we join Cuban people in paying tribute to President of the Republic of Cuba and the leader of the Cuban Revolution, Fidel Castro Ruz. Madam Chairperson, one of the greatest leaders and giants of our times lives no more. For over a half century, the lives of freedom fighters in Africa, Asia, and Americas were enriched by the intellectual astuteness of Fidel Castro that helps them to sharpen their strategies and tactics. We oftentimes use the ones who are ahead of us or have gone before us in this journey of life as a compass to guide our steps and a mirror to measure our worth to the course we have embarked on. For us in South Africa, Fidel Castro is one such compass that we who have been fighting for what the United Nations label a crime against humanity, apartheid, have used as a guide for the commitment to the cause of liberation, activism, and solidarity. We say this, Madam President, because we are witness to this selflessness and internationalism in his and the Cuban people's contribution to our struggle against apartheid and in the cause of liberation in Africa as a whole. We say Fidel Castro and the people of Cuba are the embodiment of internationalism because we witness their commitment to the liberation of Africa. And where they then, at the battles of Cuito Canavale in 1987-1988, as they lost their life fighting for the freedom of people of Angola, Namibia, and South Africa. As they stopped the then huge apartheid fighting machine from moving deep into Angola and throwing them back into apartheid South Africa to make sure that the train of freedom that was going southwards should not stop. And that is why we are standing here today, Madam Chairperson. Cuba was not looking for gold, diamonds, and oil in Africa. The Cubans only wanted to see freedom an end to the treatment of Africa as a playground of powerful nations while people suffer. That is the Fidel Castro we in South Africa bear testimony to and use as our compass. That selfless character and a true revolutionary. It is indicative of the caliber of the person Fidel Castro was, in particular, and the Cuban people in general, that they gave of themselves despite the negative effects of economic embargo. Madam Chairperson, further testimony of Fidel Castro and the Cuban people upliftment of the African adage, I am because we are, can be seen through the medical training program between Cuba and various African countries, including South Africa. That has benefited hundreds of doctors from the poor families and background and with that training in Cuba. Since the program of inception, over 2,000 otherwise poor black children from South Africa have received medical benefits in Cuba. Madam Chairperson, for us in South Africa, the most pregnant lesson from Fidel Castro's life in particular, from Cuban people in general, is the value of solidarity. South Africa will never forget Fidel Castro and his unshaken anti-colonial and anti-apartheid beliefs and works. He was a great friend and ally to the liberation movement and the people of South Africa. May his soul rest in peace. I thank you.
We're grateful to those words of the ambassadors from the various Southern African countries. And while they couldn't be here with us, we're grateful that we've got these inspiring comments. Many of us who had the opportunity to be in the United Nations when the UN paid homage to Fidel Castro, it was really quite a remarkable occasion. I'm going to ask you all for my forgiveness, to forgive me. We have with us a very special guest who I failed to acknowledge when we first began, and I want to ask Cuba's new ambassador to the United Nations, who we're going to hear from later, to please stand. Please help me welcome the Honorable Ana Yancy Rodriguez Camejo. Know that you are loved. We are grateful that you're here with us, and we're grateful to, I told you New York is kind of special, and we're grateful to have not only the mission, but the mission staff, all of you who are here representing the mission. We'd like to just ask you all to please stand and recognize our family from the Cuban mission. What a beautiful sight for you all to make your way uptown to be with us tonight means the world. So thank you so much for coming out and for being here. We are very appreciative and grateful. We want to now move on with our program. Perhaps one of the most important aspects of Fidel Castro's legacy was the establishment of the Latin America School of Medicine, known by its Spanish acronym as ELAM. Indeed, ELAM, a naval base that was converted into an institute of medical training, represents a hugely significant part of Fidel's living legacy. As I often refer to it as a generous gift that keeps on giving. Many of us will recall with great pride when Fidel addressed an overflow crowd in New York City at the historic Riverside Church in September 2000. Reverend James Forbes was there, Ruby Sprott was there, and a lot of you in this room were there. And we heard him offer free medical school scholarships to qualified candidates from all regions of the United States. Right? From low-income communities and communities of color who would not otherwise have access to medical education. The only obligation of scholarship recipients is to return and practice in medically underserved communities in the U.S. Please join us now in welcoming one of the 145 U.S. graduates of ELAM, currently working as a pulmonary fellow at Jamaica Hospital, Dr. Joaquin Morante. Doctor.
Good evening. Rather. I look at this picture of Malcolm and Fidel, and it's what guided me in my youth. It's very nice to see. Anyway, in 1998, just a quick brief history, I know Gail already got to it. 1998, Hurricane George, Hurricane Mitch affects the Caribbean and Central America, and Cuba does what Cuba does. It sends out doctors to take care of people, people in need. And in that time is where El Comandante Fidel Castro comes up with this brilliant idea to not just give people fish, but to teach them how to fish. So in the span of 1 year, this is how amazing things are, because you took a look at a timeline. 1998, this happens in by March 1999, Cuba is already training doctors from Central America. In 1 year, he had set up what used to be a naval base into a medical school, an international medical school. That's just amazing. That is just amazing. So now we have over 180 countries that have sent their students to be trained in Cuba. And as of 2000, and since 2005, at least 28,000 graduates that I have, you know, that I was told of. That's. So ELAM is a product of visionary thinking. And it is more important now than ever. As we grapple with how to care for the poor here in our country, Cuba has offered us an example of how to develop a healthcare infrastructure that cares for the basic needs of its population. At this time, when our own country is estimated to have 26 million uninsured, when the president is actively, not my president, but this president, is actively pursuing how to roll back an admittedly imperfect solution to expand coverage to its population, we can see the genius in Fidel Castro's vision. Yeah. As I look at the great difficulties that we have in constructing a system that puts its citizens first, I stand amazed at what Fidel Castro's guiding hand was able to produce, or is able to produce. In the time that I was in ELAM, I was changed. I was changed because Fidel gave us, something very important. He gave this brother, born in East Harlem, raised in New York City, an opportunity to train side by side with international comrades, with Brazilians, with Argentinians, Uruguayans, Chileans, Mexicans, Nicaraguenses, Hondureños, all of Central and Latin America, with Africa, with Southeast Asia, and changed my perspective of what I was gonna be as a professional. So what he gave us is something that now we owe to our people. He taught us how to be better human beings, to take care of other human beings. Currently, U.S. graduates now practice in family medicine, internal medicine, emergency medicine, HIV/AIDS, and even healthcare administration. That's just where we're going, to infiltrate a system and make it built and produce a goal of taking care of other human beings without this belief that we're gonna get rich, without the belief of I need to be a dermatologist to pay off my $500,000 in loans. He gave me, and he has given my compañeros and compañeras, a gift to be better revolutionary doctors. And revolutionary, I mean, to change the way we think as healthcare practitioners. So this, in this academic year, we have 29 new graduates with 10 prospective graduates going down also. And as we turn it out, we will continue to turn the system upside down. And I only mean that in the sense of we will continue to put people first, our community first, the well-being and the health of our neighbors first, because Fidel Castro gave me that. So, Fidel Castro, el comandante Fidel Castro, presente.
Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, Dr. Morante. I want to ask, I know there's at least one, but I want to ask if there are any other graduates of Elam in the audience? Damien? Yes. Excellent. Damien Suarez. Damien Suarez here. And I want to ask our sister, Daisy Bugatti. Excellent. Indeed, indeed, that's great.
All right, a couple of more pieces of information. This event is being live streamed. So for anybody who can't be here right now, for the people who are here in the audience to share this information, if you can, if there are folks who you know wanted to come and couldn't, at picturethestruggle.org. So thank you to the folks working hard on all the audio and video sides of this, all the technical sides of this to make this happen. And one more thing, another guest we want to recognize and honor who's just arrived is former political prisoner, Sekou Odinga of the Black Panther Party and the Black Liberation Army is here with us tonight. Honored to have you. Next up, we saw in the video, and we know well the special connection of the Southern African nations to Cuba, to the Cuban people, to Fidel, because of the support that the revolution offered to the national liberation struggles there, and to the struggle against apartheid. And so next, we have a poetic tribute written by a South African named Zenzele Khoisan. It will be read by our sister, Salah Cyril. She's a member of the Malcolm X grassroots movement the executive director of Little Maroons, a parent-supported childcare co-op in Brooklyn that offers an African-centered curriculum rooted in indigenous wisdom. And she's going to be reading a poem for us.
Hasta la victoria siempre. Farewell, Comandante Fidel. That's the name of the poem. By Zenzile Hosan. A giant has fallen. Indeed, a blazing light of progress has raced through the stratosphere. A most exceptional symbol of humanity's finest attributes has taken leave of a planet in distress, left bereft by the passing of its most humble, dedicated servant. Hasta la victoria siempre. Hasten the dawn of victory is the call of all the damned, the disconsolate, the downtrodden who found a guiding light in Fidel, comandante of the poor, compadre to all the warriors who rise against the oligarch, the militarists, the robber barons, the gusanos who have no mother, no motherland, no love for the people of no property. Comandante Fidel Castro Ruz, presente. You are here, the work of your hands visible everywhere. The remarkable legacy of sacrifice. The remarkable legacy of sacrifice and service across your revolutionary aisle, where you carved a path of dignity for sugarcane cutters, lifted the rod against the charlatans who terrorized the peasants, burned down the temples of elites, cut sugarcane with your own hands, never betrayed the ideals, the freedom quest that ignited revolutions worldwide. Guy Segure, go well, commander of the international campaign against the money changers, the ruthless exploiters that mortgaged the sweat of factory workers, broke the back of miners, denied education to the children of campesinos, turned the planet into a giant gambling house of speculation, the fiction that imperialism is invincible. Fidel, you who penned a love letter to the world, inspired thousands and thousands of your vibrant countrymen and women to race into the headwinds without hesitation, to face the challenge in Venezuela, Peru, Vietnam, Ethiopia, Tunisia, Congo, Angola, East Timor. Whenever humanity called, Cuba answered with its dedicated doctors, its witty dancing diplomats, its teachers, engineers, and its warriors. The determined soldiers nurtured on a true love for the human family to raise the flag of progress, put the tyrant to the sword. Go well, fiery orator. You always took the people into your confidence, sought the counsel of the scorned, the damned, never took the food out of the mouths of children, revealed the truth to the lost, lived a simple life. Your only wealth, the accumulated victories of the dispossessed. You who survived, outlived every plot to celebrate a glorious retirement. Comandante Fidel Castro Ruz, presente. Yesterday you took your leave, absolved, acquitted, defiant to the very end, always conscious of the designs, the schemes of the empire, 90 miles across the water, never succumbing to the bribes, magnificent engineer of the new day, you have earned your right to fly free through the universe. Even as the people of the planet rise to the occasion, accept your challenge of never submitting. Farewell, Comandante Fidel. Hasta la victoria siempre.
Thank you, Sister Sala. Next up is our sister Ninaj Raoul, director of Haitian Women for Haitian Refugees. For nearly 20 years, Ninaj has worked as a tireless advocate for Haitian refugees, many who began their odyssey escaping persecution following the coup d'etat of Aristide in 1991. Many were arrested at sea by the U.S. Coast Guard and ended up in detention in Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, where Ninaj served as a Creole interpreter. And upon her return to the U.S., she helped to found Haitian Women for Haitian Refugees, assisting refugees to fight for immigrant and worker rights, work that continues today with the recent refugee crisis at the southern U.S. border, and she's here to talk a little bit about the relationship between Haiti and Cuba. Nina.
Good evening. I want to say a little bit about, I was born in Chicago to Haitian parents. Both of my parents moved to New York in the 1950s. And they met here in New York. And they were married in September of 1960. And, they didn't have money, so they didn't have like a wedding. They just got married at the church. And afterwards, they moved to Chicago the next day, because my father had gotten a job there. So the day that they got married, on the way to the airport, they went by, they were going through Harlem, and then my mother lived on the Upper West Side, where a lot of Haitians lived at the time. And it was the day of that meeting with Malcolm and Fidel, and the crowd was outside, and they stopped the car and got out the car, and Fidel came out on the, on the balcony and waved, and they waved, and they got back in the car and went on to the airport, moved to Chicago. So I grew up, I had the opportunity of growing up knowing about Fidel, because my parents always talked about him. My mother always kept a picture in her wallet from that time, of the picture of Fidel eating a hot dog that she cut out the newspaper. And I always used to say, who is that man eating a hot dog, when I was little? And so, but I grew up learning, and fortunately my father decided to take us when I was a teenager to Cuba in 1978. And so I really appreciate that my parents, you know, taught me and instilled certain principles in me. But Haitian people in general, Fidel has a special place in their heart because of the relationship and the history of the Caribbean. You know, both Haiti ousted the French in 1803. And 1804, Thomas Jefferson and the U.S. imposed sanctions on Haiti, which lasted over 60 years. So that was a blockade, and that was an embargo. And we hear, you know, Haiti survived that, and just the threat of a revolution to the U.S. was a scare to all slave owners, you know. But Haiti not only survived that, but went on to help liberate Latin America from the Spanish, despite the challenges of sanctions and war. But to this day, Haiti is still paying for that revolution and continues to be attacked by the U.S. through military interventions, sanctions, oppressive policies, and mass deportations of Haitian refugees. Now, similarly, Cuba ousted the corrupt ruling class, the U.S., and their mafia. And we're going on about 60 years almost since the blockade has been going on, so you could see the clear similarities. Cuba survived because they have always continued to defend the revolution through their CDRs, through their committees to defend the revolution that are placed all over Cuba. I always wonder if, you know, Haiti would have been different if we had CDRs. We meet in the Haitian community every Friday in forums, and whenever these, we're talking about the situation in Haiti, Haitian people bring up Cuba and examples of Cuba, and I always say, we should have had CDRs from the beginning. That would have been different. So Fidel Castro taught so many of us around the world through his example and principles, which will live in so many of us for so many years to come. There's always going to be a struggle, but we know we won't be able to do anything as long as we won't fight for it. When I had a chance to go to the memorial in December after Fidel just passed, I learned, every time I go to Cuba, I learn so much. I go often because I go with the IFCO Pastors for Peace Caravan. And each time,
I see examples, and I learn of examples, and I'm always taking notes and saying, oh, this will be good for Haiti, let's take it back, and this. So, but one, you know, I learned so much from hearing from the Cuban people, more about Fidel, and what the beautiful thing about it is we know how many times there were attempts to kill Fidel, especially coming from this country. But Fidel was able to do everything he had to do. I know the first thing I did was I called my mother when I learned that he had passed away. And she cried, and I was like, look, Mom, it's okay, because he did everything he had to do while he was here. But essentially, Fidel died on his own terms, you know. And I learned when I was there in December that he said he was waiting to turn 90 to die, because that's when he knew that the youth would be able to continue the work. And that is evident when you go to Cuba and you see what's going on today. Long live the Haitian and Cuban Revolution. Que viva la revolución! Que viva Fidel Castro Ruiz! Viva! Thank you. In addition to being one of the select few U.S. citizens who have received Cuba's Medal of Friendship, Leslie Kagan. You know Leslie. Was the director of one of the early U.S.-Cuba solidarity projects called the Cuba Information Project. Does anybody remember CIP, Cuba Information Project? I have a few gray hairs, but I remember Cuba Information Project. Leslie was also a member of many of the earliest Vince Ramos brigades, as well as chair of the anti-war coalition United for Peace and Justice and co-chair of committees of correspondence for democracy and socialism. Please join me in welcoming our sister, Leslie Kagan.
Hi, everyone. Woo! Congratulations. Hi. Before I begin, I just want to take note that in 1999, on this night, an unarmed immigrant named Amadou Diallo was shot and killed by the New York City police. So I ask you to please take a moment and remember Amadou Diallo. Thank you. Thank you. I'm sorry, I'm fighting a cold. So, and tired. I don't know about anybody else, but these last few months, have been kind of busy. Anyway, I am humbled to be here tonight, to be in this room with each and every one of you. Tonight, we remember, we celebrate, and we honor Fidel Castro. But we cannot fully do that unless we are also honoring and celebrating the Cuban people and the Cuban revolution. That's okay. Thank you. Sorry about this. Fidel, the people, the revolution, there is no way to separate them out. They are one. Fidel was always anchored in his relationship to the Cuban people. Yes, he was their leader in so many ways and for so many years. But the continuity of his leadership was based on that relationship with the Cuban people. He spoke to them, and he heard what they said to him. He taught them just as he learned from them. He loved the Cuban people, and they loved him, even when they didn't always agree. At the same time, as we know, Fidel was the living example of international solidarity, an example that people around the world respected and today respect and learn from. He, and in a miraculous way, that small nation of Cuba became a leader in the global struggles against imperialism, colonialism, injustice, and war. Fidel and Cuba understood that sending doctors and teachers and technicians in many fields could be more important than sending weapons. Of course, when it was necessary to fight, whether at the Bay of Pigs or in the African struggle against apartheid, Fidel and Cuba were prepared and willing to do so. Sorry. I feel, and I hope all of you do, that my life has been blessed to live in the times of people like Fidel Castro and Ho Chi Minh and Nelson Mandela and Che Guevara, people like Malcolm X and Martin Luther King. Yes, those are all men. They are certainly all men, tall, proud men. But let us not for one moment forget the women who were so often the backbone of our struggles for freedom and justice. Let me say a few of their names. Madam Bin, Winnie Mandela, Heidi Santa Maria and Vilma Espin, Dolores Huerta and Rosa Parks. And there are those who throughout history have struggled and whose names we will never know, but whose principles and actions were just as important. People like those in the White Rose Society, a group led by students and a professor at the University of Munich in Germany. In June of 1942, they started an anonymous leaflet and graffiti campaign that called for active opposition to the Nazis. 1942. In February of 1943, their core group was arrested by the Gestapo and later was sentenced to death or imprisonment. They stood up and spoke out against fascism when too many were too silent. We need to remember that. We are in a particularly difficult time in this country, and I certainly cannot predict how this will end. Although it should give us all great hope that so many people in every corner of our country are in the streets every day. We are not going down silently. We are making a fuss. What I do know is that the lifelong struggle of Fidel has so much to teach us as we battle the authoritarian forces now in power right here at home. Fidel will always be a beacon of hope and inspiration for all of us. His legacy lives on in our struggles today and into the future, wherever they unfold in the world. This evening, we take a moment to celebrate this incredible man who led the revolutionary struggle of his people, always connecting that struggle to movements and revolutions throughout the world. We will for sure miss the man, but we will never, never forget the lessons he taught us or the example he set for us. Hasta la victoria siempre. Thank you.
Thank you, Leslie. We're going to have some more culture now. First, Frank Vergara should be a name that's familiar to many in this room. He's a member of the New York, New Jersey Cubasi Coalition that put on this event. He's a member of the July 26th Coalition. He's been active in the Puerto Rican and Cuba solidarity movements for over 40 years. He's the co-coordinator of the Pro Libertad Freedom Campaign and represents the Socialist Front of Puerto Rico in New York City. He works with the Jericho Movement, Committee to Free Leonard Peltier, and the New York Vieques Solidarity Committee. We welcome him now. He'll be sharing a beautiful poem with us that's called Mi Hermano Fidel, My Brother Fidel, which he wrote when the news of Fidel's passing reached him. So please welcome Frank Vergara.
Sisters and brothers, compañeras y compañeros, first I say to you, Oscar López Rivera is free. Oscar López Rivera is free. And we will free Puerto Rico. I stand before you tonight, the proud son of two warrior women, my mother and my grandmother, and a proud rebellious socialist who's never been afraid to claim my second homeland, Cuba Revolucionaria. Cuba Revolucionaria, mi segunda patria. I come before you with a heart full of love and rage. Love for Fidel, love for the people of Cuba, and rage that we continue to fight the powers that be, whether they be Trump or any other racist in this country. We continue to fight for the liberation of all our countries represented here. Okay, and there are many. So before I read you my poem, I want to say proudly, yo soy Fidel. Yo soy Fidel. Yo soy Fidel. Gracias, compañera y compañero. When I heard of Fidel's passing, the only thing I could compare it to is when my grandmother was ill. You know, they're getting on, it's inevitable. But when they pass, it hits you like a ton of bricks. You're never prepared for that day when you're not going to be able to kiss and hold them any longer. So I cried, and in my sorrow, I got on my computer and I wrote this. This is the first time I read one of my poems publicly, and I've been writing since 1970. Fidel me inspiró eso. Gracias, Fidel. Mi hermano Fidel, Te conocí en los ojos de mi querida abuela, mujer guerrillera, militante del Partido Nacionalista de Borinquén. Te conocí cuando encontré mi verdadero camino, boricua rebelde, socialista, militante por un Puerto Rico libre. Te conocí en cada protesta de mis hermanos y hermanas indígenas, negro, asiático, cuando con puño en alto gritaban todo poder al pueblo, abajo el racismo. Te conocí cuando entendí y aprendí a reclamar en voz alta, segunda patria, Cuba revolucionaria. Tu historia es mi historia, compartida con la humanidad. Tu indignación ante la injusticia es mi indignación. Tu pueblo es mi pueblo. Eres de todos nosotros los pueblos rebeldes y en lucha, de las grandes masas que aspiran a un mundo mejor. Tu ejemplo dice patria, proclama pueblo cimarrón, revolución de valor y sacrificio, amor verdadero y candente. Gloria eterna a mi hermano y camarada, orden y mande, comandante, presente estamos. My emotional language is Spanish, but I translate everything because I know my reality. To my brother Fidel, I met you in the eyes of my beloved grandmother, a warrior woman, militant member of the Nationalist Party of Puerto Rico. I met you when I found my real path in life, militant Boricua socialist dedicated to the struggle for a free Puerto Rico. I met you in every protest of my black, indigenous, and Asian brothers and sisters when they raised their fists high with the battle cry, all power to the people, fight racism. I met you when I understood and learned how to demand and proclaim loudly, Revolutionary Cuba is my second homeland. Your history is my history, shared with all of humanity. Your indignation in the face of injustice is my indignation. Your people are my people. You belong to all peoples in rebellion and struggle for freedom, to the dispossessed masses who dare to aspire to a better world. Your example says homeland. It gives honor to defiant people in struggle. It speaks volumes of revolution, courage, and sacrifice. It is true love. Eternal glory, my brother and comrade. Orden y mande, comandante, presente estamos. Gracias.
Thank you, friend. All right, now we've got another treat for you all. We are very excited to welcome the world-renowned Cuban jazz pianist Daramir González Lisset and the composer and violinist Tatiana Perez. Daramir was born in Havana during the special period, where, thanks to the commitment of the Cuban Revolution, the leadership of Fidel, despite facing the shortages that they were facing at this time, he had access to high-quality, free musical education. After studying at some of the most prestigious institutions for music in Havana, he became the first Cuban national to be awarded a full scholarship to the Berklee College of Music in Boston. Needless to say, he's an incredibly talented and brilliant composer and performer. He's the recipient of numerous awards both in Cuba and the U.S. Today he lives in New York, where he's founded the Art School of Contemporary Performance and Creativity to provide comprehensive, accessible music education to young people in this city. And he'll be performing alongside Tatiana Ferrer, another wonderful composer and a talented violinist, who also attended the Berklee College of Music, where she was a World Scholarship Award recipient. She's the founder and musical director of the contemporary string ensemble String Bembe, and for the last 5 years she's worked as a teacher and coordinator of specialized music courses in Boston and New York. We are so excited and honored to have them with us tonight. Please put your hands together, Darimir Gonzalez and Tatiana Ferrer.
Before I do what I feel more comfortable doing, which is playing, this is my way of communication. I managed to craft my English a little more when I was at Berkeley, and I was able to put in my vocabulary not only 5 words, up to 10. So I will try to reuse those 10 words to be able to express how happy and how much I admire each of you guys to be here today supporting Fidel Castro and supporting the Cuban Revolution. You know, I said it and I mean it because, you know, being a revolutionary in this country, in the United States, when you raise your voice to really support the Fidel Castro, to support everything, the good thing that Fidel Castro, the great thing that Fidel Castro have done, not only for Cuba, for the whole Latin America, the example that Fidel Castro represents, for everything that he has been able to have the foundation, for not only the one who are low income, no, for everybody, this is really the revolution. It's really hard to be a revolutionary in this country because the media, everybody wants to squish you, everybody want to close your mouth, to say, don't say the truth, do not say what people don't want to hear. And people like me, you know, I'm always fighting against those people. I'm always trying to portray the great thing that the revolution has done for us. And it's very, you know, it's very inspirational, you know, because I grew up in a family where we definitely support the Cuban Revolution. And since I was 16 years old, I was able to travel the whole world, going to Canada, Copenhagen, Paris, Madrid, Barcelona, everywhere, performing with Buena Vista Social Club, performing with Omar Apotuondo, performing with Chucho Valdez, with everybody in the world. In the most prestigious stages in the world. Now I'm here, living here in the United States, and was able to really put in a balance, you know, the great things that we actually have in Cuba. This is something that happens that is very funny, and I will make it in a very simple example. I will say that probably just 10% of Cubans that live in Cuba have a picture in front of the capital, of the Cuban capital. And many Americans, or let's say foreign people that go to Cuba, they are dying to go to Cuba to have that picture there. So it's kind of what you have there, I mean, what you have, what you born listening to that, you know, take it for granted, you know, the special education that we have. And somehow many Cubans, unfortunately, don't appreciate what we have. And now being here in this country, where you know that this country could be great for 13 cents, but please, do not get sick. If you get sick, that is good. Go home. Seriously. You can tell me whatever, that your economy, whatever, you know. I mean, don't get sick in the country. You get cancer, forget about it, you know. If you are not part of the 1 point, how you call it, the first, the 1% of those richer Jewish people, whatever, forget it, you know. Okay, it doesn't happen. But just I want to say that that I'm very, very happy to see the immense support that the Cuban Revolution continue to, you know, to have, and the great legacy that Fidel Castro really put here for us. I didn't graduate from Elam, you know, but I graduated from, you know, the National School of Music and the Institute of Cuban Art, which is one of the strongest music education in the entire world. When I go to Berklee College of Music, I realized how good, how well prepared I was. You know, many friends of mine, they were also kidding, playing the drums, singing amazing, but they didn't have the amazing foundation, as you know, that I had in everything, you know. Being not only, and the difference was, not only to be just a simple piano player that I can go here to play. No, you have to be an artist, you have to be a leader, you have to be a model that people have follow what you, you know, follow your example in many ways. For example, and imagine that you get to Berkeley and you see these amazing drummers, but they don't know nothing about politics. They don't know about, you know, healthcare. They don't know about social service, social stuff that happened in the world in general. So you have to be very, you know, general. You know, everything to be combined. I'm going to perform for you guys today two songs. The first one is going to be piano solo, I'm going to dedicate it to Fidel Castro, because I will always say that when I hear the word of Fidel, it comes to me gratitude. That's the first thing that I always say. Thank you, Fidel Castro, for being able to provide amazing opportunity for us to have education. Free education, but a comprehensive education, and runs the program. It's amazing because in this country, education and healthcare is not a priority. You know that. You know, it's a luxury to go to Berklee College of Music. I was the only Cuban accepted. But I always say, Harold Lopez Nusa was killing what could have been in my position. Rolando Luna, Aldo Lopez Gavilan, so many amazing Cuban piano players that could have been in the same position like me, not only me. You know, I'm the result of many, many, many artists that have been developing a great career in Cuba. Sense of the foundation that we have. And I will play the first song that is called Manicero, the Pino Bender. It's a very popular song, Cuban song. And I want to give a big hug, you know, to our friends in the Cuban missions. Porque I know, yo sé que ustedes están aquí en el forefront, luchando por nuestros ideales y manteniendo a Cuba bien en alto. Un beso para todos ustedes y le tengo mucho respeto, sin duda. And today's special because I'm bringing today my wife, Tatiana Ferrer. Come here before you perform. It is special because Tatiana, in 2010, we met, and she comes from not a wealthy family, but let's say economically stable family in Los Angeles. I would say capitalism family. And she was. I do have a point. I haven't finished, okay? I'm still working my 10 words, okay? I haven't finished.
Still learning English.
I'm still working
He's still
on
learning
it.
English.
What I want to say is that, you know, we have been together, and she was able to realize by going firsthand and experiencing firsthand the amazing thing that we have in Cuba, that Cuba is an example also for the United States, that there is a lot of social stuff that has to be included here in this system. And I would like you please to tell your experience in short words about your experience this year being together and being close to Cuba.
Hi, how are you guys doing? The first time I went to Cuba in 2011, I was very impressed with the way the government prioritized education and for, you know, growing up as an American, and realizing later in my, you know, growing up in my late teens and early 20s, realizing that our education system here is just so below average. And I always fought for the, and ever since I had developed that or understood that our education system was just terrible, I always had this vision in my mind to improve the education system in this country. And I want to at least try to do that through music. That's where I want to go. And Cuba's definitely that example. So we're going to play for you some things that represent what we stand for. Thank you.
Thank you. I want to say that we have today one of the biggest supporters of the Cuban Revolution, someone that had the opportunity, the luxury, the pleasure to meet personally Fidel Castro, and actually someone who was able to organize the first visit to Fidel Castro to the South Bronx in 1995. We have here Julio Pavón. I want to invite Julio Pavón. Come here, please. Come here, Julio. Come here. Julio Pavón, one of the biggest supporters of the Cuban Revolution. Julio Pavón had this book that is called Knockout, where he put together all his memory of that amazing opportunity to bring in Fidel Castro, against all pronostic. You know, Julio, say briefly a little bit about this book, please.
I just want to say that 1995, I've been a South Bronx resident since 1956, and I'm just tired that I'm tired of other people saying our stories. I'm tired of other people reporting our stories. I'm not a writer, I'm not an author, but my kids kept on telling me, you should write it. It took me 2.5 years, and you know, we got so much support from the Cuban government. The bottom line is, we wrote the book, Knockout, Fidel Castro Visits the South Bronx, and it was against an insult by Mayor Giuliani. I'll let you read it and tell me what you think. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
excellent. For those of you in the front, just turn around. Just take a look. Just take a look at this overflow crowd. Wow. I'm sorry we don't have more seats, but it's very heartwarming to see so many people filling this room, and we're grateful that you're here. I want to just mention two things before we ask our next speaker to come up. Number one is I'd like to recognize Reverend Herbert Daughtry in the house. Reverend Daughtry from the House of the Lord Church in Brooklyn, great friend of Cuba. Thank you so much for being here. I know that you were out and paying homage to Amadou Diallo, who we lifted up earlier tonight, but thank you for being here this evening. The other thing I want to say is for those of you to my right, your left, Take a look at this beautiful mural. Is this mural gorgeous or what? Stunning, stunning. But in order for it to stay that way, we've been asked for folk not to lean against the wall because that could, you know, have some impact and damage against the mural. So I know it's difficult. Those of you who are willing to give up seats for those who are standing, that's wonderful. If we can, again, try to prevent the elevator and the stairs from being blocked, that would also be very appreciated. There are three seats here in the front. Two. We got four seats here. We got two seats over here. So come on forward, folk, and grab a seat. And while you're doing that, I'm going to introduce the next speaker. We're honored on this special occasion to introduce to New York Cuba's new Cuban ambassador to the United Nations. It's an opportunity for New York's Cuba solidarity community to receive this newly appointed diplomat to the UN, the Honorable Aniancy Rodriguez Camejo. Okay. Gotta get it right. The ambassador comes to us from Switzerland, where for 3 years she served as Cuba's ambassador to the UN office in Geneva and representing Cuba among other international organizations throughout Europe. She holds a bachelor's degree in international economic relations from the Raul Roa Garcia Higher Institute of International Relations in Havana, Cuba. She has credentials in the international relations and development field from the International Institute of Social Studies at The Hague and the Netherlands. And it is with profound pleasure that I have the opportunity to introduce you to our ambassador. Bienvenido.
Wow, listening to Gay, I wonder if that was me. it's really a pleasure to be here. I want all of you, dear friends, but I would say more than friends, dear sisters and brothers of Cuba. From New York, from Harlem, from Latin America, from other parts of the world, and from Cuba. On behalf of our permanent mission to the United Nations, I would like to sincerely send to all the organization that has done a lot in order to prepare this great event, to celebrate the light of our common leader, of our Fidel. And a matter of great emotion for all of us that this event takes place precisely here, in a place that is a symbol for the Harlem community, for this city and for this country. For the Cuban people, this is an emblematic place for the same reason it is for you as well. And also for what it meant to Fidel, his relationship with leader Malcolm X, who gave his life in this place. We are also here to pay tribute to his memory, to the memory of Malcolm X. It is indeed particularly difficult to put into short words the sense we are filled with when we speak about someone who we see as a father, someone which is very close to all of us, and who is by far a revolutionary leader of worldwide renown. Allow me simply to refer to moments of his life that connected him to this city and to its people. Just like Cuba's national hero José Martí did while preparing the necessary war to free Cuba from Spain, little more than 60 years later, Fidel also arrived in New York in October 1955, with the same purpose, by the way, to unite these wills of patriotic and honorable Cubans and Americans for reorganizing the revolutionary movement and raising funds for the fight. It was New Jersey, the place where Fidel organized the first out of six revolutionary clubs founded in the United States. However, it was precisely here in Manhattan on October 10, 1955, in an event that involved the presence of nearly 800 people, when he made that historic commitment that you all know. In 1956, we will be free or we will be martyrs. The promise, as you know, was fulfilled. And in 1956, the Grand Magist set sail from Mexico on a journey to history, the history that we shared. But let us recall now his first trip to New York after the triumph of the revolution. He came in September 1960 to attend the United Nations General Assembly, but this time as the victorious head of government to the rebel Iceland. Let us then go through the scenario of that new encounter with the New York City. Only 1 year after the triumph of 1959, the hostility of the United States government against Cuba was growing exponentially. The Central Intelligence Agency was practically ready for the mercenary aggression that would take place in the spring of the following year, in 1961. And here, in the United States, the Cuban delegation was received by the authorities with deep hostility. Additionally, the civil rights movement here was filled with such effervescence, and its main component was the fight against racial discrimination. So, within this context, the delegation of Barbudos, led by Commander-in-Chief Fidel, arrived in New York. Even though he had many things to speak before to the United Nations General Assembly, and he did it, loud and clear, to spread all over the world the truth about the young Cuban revolution and to express his views on the serious international problems of the time, he did not forget to mention the helping hand provided to him by the people of New York. In that speech, in his speech at the UN, Fidel said, and I quote, "When we were forced to leave one of the hotels in this city and came to the United Nations headquarters, while efforts were being made to find accommodation for us, a hotel, a humble hotel of this city, a Negro hotel in Harlem offered to rent us rooms. In this community, a welcome committee had been created. One of its members was Malcolm X. The extraordinary African-American leader with whom Fidel had a meeting at his hotel room. I think a picture is there, is honoring us here. This is how, thanks to the solidarity of these people, of your solidarity, Fidel arrived at the Hotel Teresa in the heart of Harlem. Fidel also left his heart here. Nearly 20 years later, in 1979, he came back to this city to make a speech at the UN in his capacity at that moment as president of the Non-Aligned Movement. And then in the years 1995 and 2000, in these two last occasions, he could feel once again the warm sense of solidarity and friendship of these people. In the emotional meetings organized here, some of you had mentioned that before, and I really appreciate and thanks to those that were here and has organized everything for our Fidel. Fidel always returned that affection with sincerity and love. Just to recall, among many examples, the strong friendship he felt for Reverend Lucius Walker. Founder, a great friend of Cuba, founder of the movement Pastor for Peace. Lucius and Fidel felt deep respect for each other. Fidel and the people of Cuba were able to appreciate from the first moments the force of his character, the faithfulness to the principles he defended, even putting his own life at risk. His courage and his strong faith. Cuban people will never forget those images transmitted worldwide, showing Pastor for Peace activists led by Lucius, confronting heavily armed troops in the border with Mexico, seeking to take to Cuba that precious solidarity cargo. Just like Fidel, Lucius was a soldier of ideas. He asked his ashes now rests in Havana, obeying his last will. His ideas, just like Fidel's ideas, are here with us in our hearts. No reference can be made as to demonstration of solidarity from the United States to Cuba without mentioning those precursors who, defying the threats of a government against everything that implies solidarity with Cuba, formed the Venceremos Brigade. At the end of the turbulent 60s, and where the leaders of pace of heroines that we will never forget. Nor must we forget hero Carlos Muñiz Varela, member of the brigade who was killed by the enemies of the Cuban Revolution. They were seeking to prevent a normal relation to be built between our peoples. The Venceremos Brigade always held a special place in Fidel's thinking. I would like to recall fragments of his words dedicated to the brigade in a speech he gave on July 26, 1970. All of you know how what means July 26 for Cuban history and for Cuban revolution. Has been mentioning this evening a lot. Referring to them, to the Venceremos Brigade, and to the people of the United States, Fidel said, and I quote, "We are the pioneers of the revolutionary path. But not the only ones. One day, sooner or later, we will become the peoples of Latin America, not to confront a powerful imperialism, but to live in unity with a great people, the United States people. We are not the enemies of those people. Therefore, we can say to the US people and to those youth who came here to help us, who have sent us such a moving and expressive message. Yes, all of us together, together with the American people, we will win. We will win. And Fidel, with you, won. As you well know, those demonstrations of friendship and solidarity of Fidel towards his these people were also extended to the youth, based on his idea to provide them with the opportunity to study medicine in Cuba. A group of humble boys and girls from different areas of the United States, several of them from New York and from this very same neighbor of Harlem, have been able to become doctors and work in poor and African-American communities. My respect to those young doctors that are here, graduated from the Latin American School of Medicine in Cuba. We do not regard this as something extraordinary, let me say. Just like Fidel showed us, this has been a way to repay a debt of gratitude, solidarity, and friendship that looks beyond the economic dimension or any other type of consideration. We are just paying our debt with humanity. Thus, in many ways, Fidel expresses his friendship for these people. And with the passing of years, despite hostile attitudes, despite the blockade that is still causing us hardships, his feeling towards the American people remained unchanged. And in his everyday contact with our people, this was the perception he conveyed to us. This was and this is Fidel, because he is still alive in each one of us, because nobody will ever be able to speak in the past about Fidel. It was undoubtedly a real privilege for us, but I'm certain that for all of you as well, to have joined him during these years of struggle has been a great privilege. From him, we Cubans learned that for a socialist revolution to be true, it should maintain firmness on principles. There must be no doubt that whatever the scenario may be, friends, we will continue to uphold these principles today and in the future. Be sure of that. His entire life work dedicated to build that better world he believed possible, multiplies in yourselves, in your unwavering solidarity towards Cuba, and reaffirms our commitment to be faithful to Fidel's legacy. We will never forget the strong support that we have always received from the sons of Harlem and from all the honorable sons of this country. These are the same who, in an increasingly growing number, wish the lifting of the blockade and the establishment of normal and civilized relations between both countries without any conditions. Because just like Martin Luther King, Malcolm X, Lucius Walker, and Fidel had a dream, and we, the Cuban and American peoples, are the heirs of that dream. I'm deeply convinced that we will continue to struggle so that this dream can come true. Allow me to conclude with a short phrase by Fidel that expresses his feelings for this community and his people. He said it here during that visit in 1960, when the delegation had to decide where to stay after being expelled from the hotel where they had been lodged originally. The invitation for him to stay at the Hotel Teresa had been made already, and the reaction of the authorities of the time was to try to prevent it by offering free accommodation in some other hotel to the delegation of Cuba. Fidel was asked what this decision was, or what his decision was, and he replied without any hesitation, "I'm going to Harlem." He said, "I'm going to Harlem because there is where my best friends are. There is where our best friends continues are. Viva Fidel! Long live the friendship and solidarity between the peoples. Hasta siempre, comandante. Hasta la victoria siempre. Patria o muerte. Thank you."
Viva! Another veteran of this movement, another longtime steadfast supporter of the Cuban Revolution. We're going to hear next from Jaime Mendieta of Casa de las Americas. He's been there every time for more than half a century. When our communities have come together in support of Cuba, he's been there. He's one of the founding members of Casa de las Americas, a New York-based organization of Cuban immigrants in support of the Cuban Revolution. I believe it's the oldest Cuban solidarity organization in the U.S. Beginning in 1955 as the July 26th committee with the purpose of supporting the armed struggle that was underway in Cuba. This group was renamed Casa Cuba shortly after the triumph of the revolution in 1959, and it later became Casa de las Americas. Through all of these years and up to today, Casa de las Americas has been a hub for the Cuba solidarity movement in New York, a key site in every struggle that this movement has faced, most recently in the victorious fight, and we can't go without mentioning it, to free the Cuban Five, who are home today. Jaime Mendieta, standing with other comrades, continues Casa's important legacy. Please join me in welcoming him now.
The ambassador covered pretty much the 1960 trip of Fidel to the UN in Harlem, the meeting with Malcolm X, all of that. So I'm going to go into the trip before that, 1955, was Fidel's first trip to New York. Fidel came to New York to organize. He met with Cuban organizations, with the Orthodox Party, the Authentic Party, and the Cuban Labor Organization. He welded these three organizations into the 26th of July movement in New York and in the New York region of other nearby cities. The leaders of the, at that time were Arnaldo Patron, Juan Miguel Marquez, those were two main leaders. The 26th of July movement was the first phase of Casa de las Americas. Some of us who visited Casa at 14th Street met some of the original pillars of the 26th of July movement here. The, Arnaldo Barron, which is with us tonight, Gloria Barron, Eusebio Valdez, Eva Valdez, and Pablo Estremera. Pablo Estremera was a very interesting person. First president of Casa Las Americas, a bus driver from the Sierra Maestra Mountains. He, due to his knowledge of the area of the Sierra, he became the actual courier between Fidel Castro and Barron in New York, made several trips back and forth, taking, among other things, money and messages and the needs down in Cuba. Estremera was Puerto Rican. He came to Cuba at the age of 11 as an orphan and developed there into one of the leaders of the 26th of July movement. Juan Miguel Marquez was second in command of the Granma expedition. The Granma went aground in December 2, 1956. The force started a march towards the Sierra Maestra Mountains when they were ambushed on December the 5th at Gloria del Pio battle. There they became dispersed. Marcus, unfortunately, was not able to hook up with Fidel and the other 12. He was captured by Batista's soldiers, where he was beaten, left for dead. Later on, when they came to dispose of the body, they find that he was alive and he was murdered at that point. Arnaldo Barron and Eusebio Valdez were instrumental in getting Hubert Matos, Hubert Matthews, the New York Times reporter that broke the story that Fidel was still alive and still fighting in the Sierra Maestras and, you know, winning battles and doing fine. That news story changed things around. The 26th of July movement became, and Fidel and the struggle in Cuba became a worldwide phenomenon. And it really was a turning point in the struggle. In 1958, Arnaldo Barron was arrested on the vessel, the Orion. The Orion was packed with weapons and 35 uniformed others. Barron said, we lost the weapons, but not the initiative, and began a hunger strike, which the hunger strike calling for Batista to end sending the weapons to Cuba. And 5 days later, that happened. There were no more weapons, or at least the United States caved in and said they were not sending any more weapons, which wasn't true. They still sent some weapons to Guantanamo. later it was learned that the weapons were being sent. But nevertheless, it was a major political victory. The three faces of Casa de las Americas were the 26th of July movement, Casa Cuba, and Casa de las Americas. The name changes were due to the massive repression by the FBI on members, on their families. Even when I joined in the mid-70s, the FBI was still on our case. They went to where I worked. They contacted my ex-wife, all the members of my family, tried to contact me. Of course, none of that worked. But I was actually very lucky that when they called my job at one point, I was standing in the office, and the person said I wasn't there, and then they explained to me, what did you do? The FBI is looking for you. So I was able to call who our lawyer was at that moment, a long-time defender of all the just causes. And he immediately called the FBI, and then they were apologizing. No, we just wanted to ask him some questions about some postal robbery or something. Call me back now. At that point, they were being weaker than they were early with other members of the CASA or of the 26th of July movement. So, as you can imagine, we're very proud of having been founded, having been organized by Fidel Castro Ruz. That's something, that's our legacy. And tonight we're very fortunate in having with us a founder and leader of the 26th of July movement in New York, Arnaldo Barrón. He's in that corner there. New York and the United States. It was a great honor to know him, to meet him, and learn about the movement. And so, well, that's it. Thank you.
That's some great history. Next, we have Larry Ham. This fiery, I'm going to call him fiery. Fiery, always on point, community activist, has been a relentless advocate for black people and the cause of human rights, and has been at this for more than three decades. Under the leadership of Larry, the
People's Organization for Progress, POP, an independent grassroots political organization, has been active in the Newark and Northern New Jersey area for over 30 years. POP has played an important role in the struggle for quality education, employment opportunities, access to health care, against racial profiling, police brutality, and on and on and on. He's been fighting for justice all his life. Over the past 15 years or so, POP has hosted numerous guests from Cuba, including representatives of the Federation of Cuban Women, the Cuban Ambassador to the United Nations, and other staff from the Cuban Mission. Welcome, Larry Ham.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Comandante Fidel Castro Ruz presenting. Brothers and sisters, it's a great honor for me to be here to say a few words to you tonight. I want to thank the committee for inviting me. This clearly is a historical gathering, and we stand in the vortex of history. Of course, we're here to celebrate one of the greatest revolutionaries of world history, Fidel Castro. But I stand just feet away from the greatest revolutionary of the black liberation movement, just feet away from where Malcolm X was assassinated. And today, February 4th, as has been mentioned earlier, was the day that Amadou Diallo was murdered, but it is also the birthday of another great American freedom fighter, Sister Rosa Parks. Today is her birthday. So we stand in the vortex of history. And I need to get right to the point. If we really love Fidel and everything that Fidel stood for, then we must do everything in our power to ensure the success of the Cuban Revolution. Of course, it goes without saying that one of the great accomplishments of the modern era was the Cuban Revolution, was the fact that a group of committed revolutionaries on a small island just 90 miles off the coast of Florida stood up to the giant oppressor of worldwide imperialism, the United States, and defeated them. But the great accomplishment of the Cuban Revolution was not just the victory of the revolution, but the fact that U.S. imperialism has not been able to derail the Cuban Socialist Project. So we must redouble, triple, quadruple our efforts to do everything that we can, first to ensure that diplomatic relations with Cuba are maintained, but more importantly, we must end the embargo against Cuba. End it once and for all, in our lifetime, in our lifetime. If there's something that we could say positive about the Obama administration, it is that they renewed diplomatic relations with Cuba. But we must take heed and caution from our Native American brothers and sisters who understand that these people speak with forked tongue. They give with one hand and they take away with another. While the Obama administration renewed diplomatic relations with Cuba, at the same time, under the Obama administration, they doubled the bounty on Asada Secure to $2 million. We hope that the Cuban people, we know that the Cuban people will not let them take Asada Secure. We know that the Cuban people will stand and protect Asada Secure. So we have a lot of work to do. I was 17 years old when I really began to learn about the Cuban Revolution, the great revolutionaries Fidel Castro and Che Guevara and many others. And while we are here to celebrate the icon of revolution, Fidel Castro, we celebrate not just Fidel, but the entire Cuban people who stood steadfast and in solidarity with revolutionary struggles all over the world. And how did I learn about Fidel Castro? I learned about Fidel Castro through a great revolutionary that the city of Newark produced, Amiri Baraka. It was Amiri Baraka who taught many of us, including Brother Zaid, about not just the Cuban Revolution, but all revolutions. And it was Amiri Baraka that first, he had a bookstore called Nyumba ya Ujamaa, the House of Cooperative Economics. And it is there that I bought my first copy of History Will Absolve Me by Fidel Castro. So many of us today, we are revolutionaries because of Fidel Castro, because we were inspired by example. And lastly, the best way that we can pay tribute to Comandante Fidel, the best way that we could uphold his great legacy is to make revolution right here in the United States of America. That is the greatest tribute that we could pay to Fidel Castro. Viva Fidel!
Viva,
viva Fidel!
Viva!
Long live the Cuban Revolution! Power to the people!
Thank you again, Larry, reminding us of the work ahead. We've got a couple cultural pieces coming up, and then we're going to get you home. You heard him earlier. You're going to hear him again right now, along with some more performers. Jose Ortiz, also known as Dr. Drum, a Bronx native, self-taught percussionist, specializing in Afro-Caribbean rhythms. He's an advocate for cultural arts. He's been active as an organizer and an educator for many years. He's together here with Bomba Yo, a group that emerges from the streets and schoolyards of the Bronx. And under the direction of Dr. Drum and Melinda Gonzalez, Bomba Yo's young people bring new energy to a centuries-old Afro-Puerto Rican music and dance tradition, Bomba. So please give it up one more time. Coming to the stage now, Dr. Drum and Bomba Yo.
One of the earliest classical musics that were performed by African descendants before the European marginalization of that music, that foundation, was performed by drums. And I think that, you know, where we are today with music, a lot of people have taken for granted what that means. And so I want to talk about this particular time because in 1791, we know what happened after the Haitian Revolution, but there was something that happened right at the beginning. That's part of the history, and drummers know that history. We know what that revolution means, because without the drums, that revolution would not have started. So let's make sure that we understand what the drums mean to our music. And everything else that happened while the string instruments came in and all that, that's okay, that's all good. But this is the foundation. These are the roots. When we talk about the African diaspora, this is the evidence of those roots. It's our drums. And it was in 1791 when they chanted, hey, bomba one. And that's exact. Those are the exact words, and it's documented. You can read that, right? You can look it up. But meantime, while we're here today, this is what's beautiful about our drums and about our roots. For some people, it's a story of history. But for those that live it day by day, it is our present, and we don't let go. We do not forget. We always remember, and we honor that with our drums. And that's why we're here today, to share that with you. Hey, hey, bomba one one. Hey, bomba one one. Ay, kangali. Hey, bomba one. Ay, kanga papute.
Canta aquí. ambassador or what? Did I? Dr. Drum. Bamba Yo. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Okay. Yes, I did. I did. I did. Okay, so listen, I know that we're all fired up. We're all fired up. But I want to ask my dear brother Zaid Muhammad to come forward. As he's coming forward, I want to tell you something about this brother. I met him 25 years ago. We were traveling on our first Vincent Ramos Brigade caravan, 1992. And I've known him ever since, and he is one of the most principled, stand-up, revolutionary brothers I know. And I'm honored to have him come forward and to share his poetic tribute with us. Brother Zaid Muhammad.
Frankie Valgara basically set up what I'm going to try to do with the few minutes that I have allotted to me with his remarks and with his presentation. And Frankie, we've known you for a long time. You holding out on all them stories. You got to share them. I hope Frankie hears us, all right? This is called Red Star for Fidel. It begins with a quote and is framed by some music. Quote, the Cuban Revolution, that's the revolution. They overturned the system. That's Malcolm X, message to the grassroots, November 10th, 1963. People make the world go round. Comandante Fidel has decided that it was time that he left us. After showing an impoverished but pretty people how the wealth and power of unity and principle, courage and creativity, collective work and solidarity can transform their lives. After refusing to say uncle to the bully of empire that is Uncle Sam. After the turning of Cold War pawns of the Cuban people into Carlotta knighted warriors, checkmating apartheid in their own blood and battle into rumba rocking raging rooks and agents of change. After 9 decades of defiance and dignity, nine decades, Comandante Fidel has decided that it was time that he left us. And so he did. On wings whirlwind wide, lifted by lyrics of Guillen, of Neruda, of Corriere, of Matos Pauli, of Baraka, of Cortez, of his Colombian compañero, Gabriel Garcia Marquez, the great giant man with the beard, the tall eyes, and the long lungs has left us. On wings whirlwind wide, flying high with that gallant green fatigue stride, guided by that white dove, seeking the ultimate love from up above in pursuit of a place pain-free, disease-free, exploitation and strife-free, a place well beyond the CIA, sinister dead presidents and soon-to-be dead presidents. A place beyond casualties and the trauma of war, a cane sugar sweet place, a place of peace, a harvest and feast, a place where he is now a cherished new red star blazing bold in a liberated blue sky. He has left us for a place of memory and the kissed and taste of eternal justice and victory to meet and kneel before Maceo and Marte, to reunite with Che, to be received with an ovation by a column of martyrs and the revolutionary departed. He has left us for that place that chiseled him into a cherished brand new red star, forever burning bright in a liberated blue sky. So in this moment, as we wring our eyes of the truth of his new absence, as we face these clear and present dangers, as familiar and as sinister as ever, we remember what we have done together with our own hands and hearts while he was with us. What we did together, no matter the obstacles or hostilities, and we say, yo soy Fidel, I am Fidel, and continue against the tyranny and tantrum that is this backwards blockade. We continue and we say, yo soy Fidel, I am Fidel. Against the evil of poverty and treatable disease, we snap the wrist of this order of exploitation responsible for this needless suffering, and we say, yo soy Fidel, I am Fidel. Against the rot of racism that engenders hate, torture, mass suffering, genocide, and death, against the sex sickness of sexism that barbarically violates women and girls, deforming and stunning all human development, we continue and we say, yo soy Fidel, I am Fidel. Against the gloating of the global pharmaceutical complex, taunting the suffering with their high prices and flippancy, against the seductive mischief-making of the marketeers, against the handshaking deceit of the vampires of capital, we continue and we say, yo soy Fidel, I am Fidel. So now that he has left us with our history and heritage of hope full in our hands, we continue to provide sanctuary for the empire's persecuted, continue to build and fight for human development, to meet human needs wherever there is suffering, continue to share everything we have, no matter how meager, as a matter of principle, as the profiteers cringe at our refusal to capitulate, as we sing, dance, train, and fight to their dismay and to our delight, we continue with the light of Che in our eyes, inspired by Fidel's brand new blazing red star shining in a liberated blue sky, we continue and we say, yo soy Fidel, I am Fidel. From our oldest and most battle-born to our youngest between school and play, from our hotel workers patient with the petty of tourists to campesinos proudly working their land, from lovers strolling along the Malecón to our most advanced itchings of science, from the singing Sierra Maestra mountains to the muscular cuddle of the countryside, we continue and we say, yo soy Fidel, yo soy Fidel, yo soy Fidel, yo soy Fidel, I am Fidel, I am Fidel, I am Fidel, and we continue. That's what makes the world go round and up and down the carousel, changing people's heads around, go underground, young man. People make the world go round. People make the world go round. Yo soy Fidel, yo soy Fidel, yo soy Fidel, yo soy Fidel.
Thank you for that beautiful tribute, Zaid. We finally reached the conclusion tonight, and we believe that the most appropriate way to close the evening and to leave is with the image and the words and the voice of Fidel himself. So thanks again to the work and the video editing talent of Jennifer Wager and Sally O'Brien. We present a compilation of Fidel himself, the last time our beloved Comandante was in New York, 1995 and 2000. We leave you with this.
Revolución es sentido del momento histórico. Es cambiar todo lo que debe ser cambiado. Es igualdad y libertad plena. Es ser tratado y tratar a los demás como seres humanos. Revolución es unidad, es independencia, es luchar por nuestro sueño de justicia para Cuba y para el mundo, que es la base de nuestro patriotismo, nuestro socialismo y nuestro internacionalismo.
South Bronx, yo, grito viva Fidel, en el nombre de Luis de Miguel, yo sigo para...
Queridos, o mejor dicho, queridísimos
dear, amigos. Or rather, very dear friends.
cuando me estaba vistiendo,
while I was getting dressed,
para venir acá,
to come here tonight,
me quité de todos los trajes.
I got rid of the business suit.
Porque yo decía,
because I said to myself,
si la otra vez fui con esta ropa,
if the last time I went to Harlem I was wearing my fatigues,
¿cómo me voy a aparecer en Harlem?
How come I'm going to go to Harlem
vestido
dressed
de caballero
in a business suit?
Yo decía, tengo que venir.
I remember with such appreciation those days in which I was here in this neighborhood.
Tengo que venir a saludar,
I said to myself,
hermanos,
I have to go there and say hello to those people.
Harlem,
because it was in Harlem,
y junto con ellos, a los hermanos,
where I have to go and visit there, and together with them, the Latin American, the Puerto Rican brothers and sisters.
Yo creo que el alcalde dijo que yo era un demonio.
The mayor said that I was a demon.
Un demonio no se le podía invitar a una comida.
And that a demon could not be invited to dinner.
Caramba, voy a pasar hambre el primer día.
I said, I'll go hungry the first day in New York.
No habría faltado jamás al encuentro con usted.
But I would have never failed to come to this meeting with you.
Porque lo primero que hice,
because the first thing I did,
cuando se habló del programa,
when the program was brought up with me, was to say that I wanted to visit the Teresa Hotel and that I wanted to have an encounter with you here in Harlem.
Yo sabía que iba a contar con el
I knew that here I would have the heart of the neighbors of Harlem.
What world? What world leader, perhaps most boldly and passionately, articulates the truth that rich nations scheme and plot to keep other nations poor. Well, sisters and brothers, it is an enormous honor to present that person, His Excellency, the President of Cuba, Fidel Castro Ruz.
When all that happened over there, we offered the Central American nations,
incluso enviamos,
and we sent
cientos,
hundreds
de médicos,
of doctors,
y le propusimos planes integrales de salud.
And after that, we suggested to them to undertake comprehensive health programs.
A nuestro juicio no era cuestión de mandar un número de médicos y ayudar durante 15 o 20 días después del huracán
y
después marchar.
The problem is after that.
Porque ese huracán,
because that hurricane
mató,
killed,
según la cifra,
well, according to the figures,
más elevadas que se anunciaron, 30,000 personas.
The highest figures given at the time were 30,000.
Tal vez las cifras reales,
perhaps the real
figures, desaparecido aparecieron,
was lower than that because many missing people showed up later after
alrededor
the hurricane. But still about 15,000
died
as a result of the hurricane. And we knew
que todos los años
that every year
en Centroamérica,
in Central America,
mueren de hambre y enfermedades previsibles Más de 40,000 personas, niños.
Over 40,000 children die of
hunger. 40,000 niños cada año.
In Central America.
Luego hay un huracán permanente.
So they are suffering a permanent
mucho
hurricane,
más terrible que el
which
Mitch.
Is much worse than Hurricane Mitch or Hurricane George.
¿Por qué me he extendido un poco?
Why have
en
I been,
este tema de la medicina?
Why have I been elaborating so much on this
por ejemplo,
issue of medicine?
A todos los países
well,
del Caribe
I wanted to explain to you that to all the Caribbean countries,
hemos concedido
we have,
becas sin límites y gratuitas
without restrictions
para
I mean, free of
cualquier
charge
carrera
for
universitaria.
As many students as they want to send
no
for
son
any
muchos
career
los países
whatsoever.
Del Caribe. Son muchos países, pero la población no es.
As you know, the Caribbean countries have small populations, so they have an open quota to study in our country.
Y un legislador de Louisiana.
It was an occasion when we had a visitors
de un distrito de Mississippi.
When we had the visit of some congressmen from the Black Caucus, there was a congressman from Mississippi, and I was describing this program to them.
Oíame.
And this
yo tengo
said,
muchos distritos en mi, muchos
have,
lugares en mi jurisdicción
many places in my own district
que no tienen un solo médico.
Where they do not have a doctor.
Le digo, ¿cómo?
I said to him, how come?
Chivas, ahora me di cuenta que ustedes son el tercer
said, well,
mundo
now I realize that you are the third
de Estados
world
Unidos.
Inside the United States.
Y le di.
And I said to him,
estamos dispuestos a enviarle.
And I said to him, we are willing to send you
médicos,
our
algunos
doctors.
Médicos gratuitamente. Igual que lo hacemos con otros países del tercer mundo.
I said to him, we are willing to send you our doctors free of charge, the same way we do with other third world countries.
No siempre voy a hablar de la riqueza de Estados Unidos. Del Producto Interno Bruto que supera los 8 millones de millones de dólares, etcétera, etcétera, etcétera. Y de repente me topo con.
And all of a sudden somebody comes up to me and tells me that.
Digo, podemos enviarlo. Inmediatamente le
añadí. We can help you. But right away I said, look.
Mire, me acordé de las escuelas.
I remember the schools we have.
Estamos dispuestos a conceder un número de becas.
I said, look, we are willing to grant a number of scholarships
para jóvenes
for youth
de pobres de su distrito
for, youth from your districts
que no puedan pagar los $200,000 que cuesta una carrera universitaria. Más médicos
that now we have more doctors
y trabajadores
and
de la
more
salud.
Health workers
prestando servicios gratuitos
working free of charge
en el tercer mundo
in the third world
más
more
que en ninguna época anterior
than at any other previous time.
Nosotros estamos bien informados.
We are rather well informed
de lo que ocurre en el mundo
of what happens in the world
porque uno de nuestros principios
because one of our principles
es la solidaridad.
It's solidarity.
Para nosotros es uno de los principios más sagrados.
Solidarity is for us one of our most sacred principles.
Los que creen en el hombre.
The people who believe in man,
en la capacidad
in humankind,
de los sentimientos,
in the capacity of sentiments,
del hombre,
of man's
en la capacidad para la bondad,
in man's capacity to be generous,
del hombre,
to be kind,
los que aman al ser humano,
those who love human beings,
no podrían comprender jamás,
would never understand,
que a nosotros nos doliera,
that we were hurt,
el niño cubano. Que muere o aquellos que sufren
by
no hay que hablar solo de los que mueren
die, and not only those who die but those who suffer
y no nos preocupemos en absoluto
Nobody would understand that we care for those who die and suffer.
Por el niño haitiano.
For the Haitian children.
Guatemalteco.
For the children from
Dominican.
Guatemala, from the Dominican Republic.
Puertorriqueños.
For the Puerto Rican children.
Africanos.
For the African children.
O de cualquier otro país del mundo.
For the children of any other country.
Estamos acá hoy porque me siento revolucionaria, porque Fidel siempre pensó en los jóvenes, porque venimos a rendirle nuestro apoyo, nuestro dolor por el momento en que estamos pasando, pero seguro que su legado se va a quedar vivo. Para nosotros Fidel no ha muerto, para nosotros hoy Fidel se ha multiplicado en cada cubano y sobre todo en los niños.
Es algo emocionante, es algo muy desde lo más profundo de mi corazón. Fidel es mi ídolo, Fidel es todo. Fidel para mí es Cuba, un país, la revolución.
Vengo porque soy un joven revolucionario, que bueno, que siempre ha crecido con la revolución, que tiene un compromiso con sus principales líderes, y que apoya firmemente los principios y los valores de nuestro comandante jefe.
Desde los 13 años estoy haciendo marcha, haciendo revolución, y cada vez que me necesiten, aunque quiera estas canas, lucho desde un punto de la tierra para actuar en la gran revolución generosa por los pobres, por los humildes y para los humildes del mundo entero, porque él vivió para los humildes y murió para los humildes, patria o muerte.
Juramos defender la patria y el socialismo, y juntos reafirmemos todos la sentencia del titán de bronce, quien intente confiarse de Cuba, recogerá el poco de su suelo anegado en sangre, y no
revolución es sentido del momento.
Thank you. Thank you for being here. Thank you for honoring the life and the legacy of Fidel Castro. Thank you, Ambassador. Thank you for your spirit, your wonderful dancing, and all of our guests from the mission. We're grateful for your presence. Good night, everyone.